As a senior in high school, you learn a lot of things. But one of the things that you'll learn fastest is that starting in August, in essentially every conversation you have, somebody is going to ask you if you know where you're going to college yet. Lucky for me, I do, and this fall I'll be attending the University of Georgia. Now, if you know me at all, or have had a conversation with me in the last 2 months, you know that I could not be more excited about this. My room is decorated with red and black balloons, I wear my Georgia sweatshirt basically every day, and I yell "Go Dawgs" as loud as I can at every possible opportunity. But UGA wasn't always my plan, which leads me really nicely into what I'm actually here to talk to you all about tonight. Hi everyone, my name is Emma Shirkey, and I'm here to talk to you about the beauty of not knowing what the hell you are about to do next. So I'd like to start off by telling a story. Back in August, like millions of other teenagers across the country, I was preparing myself to apply for college. Bleh. But I wasn't as stressed out about it as I really thought I might be. Honestly, that's because I had a plan. It was the same plan that I had had forever. I was going to graduate from Oaknoll, go to Princeton University, go to medical school, become a doctor, get married, have kids, start a life for myself, and, you know, just kind of figure it out from there. Anyways, the main part of this goal was always that I was going to Princeton. But in a whirlwind turn of events, when I actually started the college process, I fell in love with another school. It was sort of like in every single teenage sports movie you've ever seen, where there's the incredibly overbearing parent that like screams down the hallway, "You're giving up on your dream!" But then like the young, talented Olympic hopeful turns around and says, "No, I'm giving up on yours." It was pretty tangling stuff to sort through because I found myself as both the parent and the kid. But I ultimately decided that I was going to apply to other places early, knowing that Princeton might just have to wait. What ended up happening was that when decision hour came, I was really nervous for my Princeton letter. I mean, who wouldn't be? It's Princeton. But my test scores were on target, and my recommendations glowed, and I had spent hours perfecting my essays, and my interviewer and I had the same favorite book, and I was an athlete and in clubs, and I had leadership positions and awards, and then I was rejected. Yeah, bummer. Rejection is a pretty scary word. It's technically defined as refusing to have, take, or recognize. But if you ask me, rejection comes from the other perspective. When you lay it all out on the line and you hear no. There's no question that it stings, but I've come to a conclusion. Rejection is great. I wanted to make sure that this was a widespread idea, though, so keeping in line with the idea of college rejection, I surveyed my classmates and peers. What I found was that seniors in high school who reported having a dream school that they wanted to attend felt that in some way they were better off for it. Some cited things like resume-building internships turning into jobs and savings. Others joined their favorite extracurriculars because they've looked good on college applications. Yet, the most overwhelming response that I received was that seniors felt that they had worked harder in their high school classes because they drew motivations from the big congratulations envelope instead of the little tiny "we regret to inform you" envelope. Yeah, bummer. But aside from the idea that rejection only happens when you're afraid of it, you can also be motivated by the idea of rejection itself. Who here has heard of a woman named Khloe Kardashian? Most of us, right? Then you might know that over the last few years, she's become somewhat of a fitness icon. But before she posed for Complex magazine or starred her own reality fitness TV show, she was repeatedly outcasted from her sisters by TV personalities as the Fat Kardashian. And then on top of that, her incredibly high-profile marriage to Lamar Odom ended in a very public manner. She's been far from shy about the way that these rejections have impacted her, but instead of wallowing in what could have been, she decided to make a switch in her life, saying, "The best form of revenge is a good body. It's not a revenge on any one particular person, but a revenge on life, and I get to be the best me." Now, when I hear that quote, I can't help but think about the millions of people who follow her on Instagram and Twitter and watch her show every Monday at 9. But I really can't help to think about how many people saw her own weight loss and decided to get healthy themselves. All of that seems pretty positive considering it's only coming from one person's rejections. Don't you agree? Aside from motivation, rejection gives us a chance to reconsider our paths, and thus an opportunity for change. Did anyone in this room know that bubble wrap was originally invented as a textured wallpaper? Or that Listerine was originally marketed as a surgical antiseptic, and then a cigarette additive, and then a cure for the common cold, and then a dandruff treatment, and then, oh yeah, mouthwash. But really, let's talk about Coca-Cola for a second. Did anyone know that inventor John Pemberton came up with the idea for America's favorite soft drink when he was trying to ease his own morphine addiction? Really, not exactly what it's used for today. But when he tried to sell this product as a general cure to anxiety, headaches, exhaustion, addiction, etc., there was just no public interest. Had he not recognized his rejection and remarketed, you and I would likely be living in a world without Coke. And following that, a world without Pepsi, and a world without modern soda. Weird, right? Anyways, one of the next facets of rejection that I find completely fascinating is the idea that it can self-correct scientifically. You see, neurologically, our dopamine levels, a chemical responsible in part for our happiness, are controlled by our expectations. When we get what we expect, our levels stay stable, but when we're pleasantly surprised, they rise, and when we're disappointed, they fall. This usually happens for pretty minor stuff, like somebody eating your favorite leftovers out of the fridge, or maybe you have a bad hair day when you have a work presentation. But when we experience rejection, a larger, harsher version of disappointment, our dopamine levels plummet. And then what happens after that is for the next few weeks, days, however long it takes you, your levels stabilize at that new lower level, and you're more easily excited by things that would have seemed mundane or boring to you before. Kind of explains the logical rebound date, right? Anyways, what all of that science talk means is that essentially, when you experience a rejection, you're gonna be pretty bummed out for a while, which makes sense. But your brain and your body as a whole is looking out for you because you're gonna find more pleasant surprises around you and you're gonna generally just like the world a little bit more. Ultimately though, the best part of rejection is that it's valuable. People tend to forget about two major things when they're denied something they care about: effort and nerve. That first big job interview that you totally just bombed, don't worry about it, you'll get the next one, you have practice now. I'm a big believer in the idea that God handles all things. You know, one door closes, another door opens philosophy. That's because in almost every scenario, there's a reason for rejection, be it a divine universe-initiated plan or our own shortcomings. If we allow it to, rejection gives us a chance to see our weaknesses. It allows us a chance to be better. To me, rejection is the most pure form of an uncharted territory. When you're climbing Mount Everest and you have a plan, you're doing just that, climbing Everest. But when that plan gets rejected, you just don't know what move to make next. You simply don't know what lies in front of you. And given the fact that we are all on this collective Everest called life, we don't really have the option of turning back around and going down the mountain. So we move forward. We move forward and we take in the views and we enjoy the climb, and then all of a sudden, we reach our peak. Thank you.